Well, you guys have been asking and asking and asking, so here it is. An actual update on my ultimate Sovol SV08 tool changer project with actual progress. And in this video, I'm going to share with you the ups, the downs.
No.
The other downs, the other downs, and the hurdles, as well as how we, Reed, mostly I, have made every mistake possible at every turn. Ultimately, I hope to give you some insight into what it really takes to build a project like this and what mistakes you can avoid should you be foolhardy enough to embark on it. Let's get after it. Now, while this is technically the second video in the series, I always like to script these videos in such a way that if you did miss the previous one, you can still jump right in right here. So feel free to skip this section if you remember where we were, or stick around if you need a refresher. For those of you who have no idea what this project is or what I'm even talking about, well, we're building a tool changer. Basically, we're turning a budget Sovol SV08 into a seven-headed monster with no expense spared and a variety of different tool head combinations. We'll have a tool head for ultra high flow. We'll have a tool head for high temperature filaments. We'll have one for abrasive filaments, and we'll have some tool heads which will be lighter weight and others which will be tailored to more flexible materials. And just a side note here, when we started this project off, A, I didn't yet have a Prusa XL, which is why we wanted to really go all out on this build, because it was at the time going to be my only tool changer. Thank you, Prusa. And B, Bondtech had not yet teased their upcoming and very exciting INDX tool changer system. For some reason, every single time I build something, something new and better immediately comes out. I build the ERCF V1 and the V2 comes out. I build the V2, so the box turtle comes out. I start a tool changer, you get the idea. It's kind of a sore subject, so please spare me the why not wait for the INDX comments down below, would ya? Now, when we last left off at the end of the last video, we had basically collected all the parts, or what we thought was going to be all of the parts, for the build from all of the various sponsors supporting me in this project. Now, I should probably thank them once again, and while I am super grateful to all of our sponsors, I definitely don't want you guys at home to feel like this whole video is a plug for different sponsors. So let's just take a quick moment to thank these awesome companies who sent over all of these parts for this project. I also, at the time of releasing the last video, had built two or three of the actual tool heads across two separate live streams. And then, in a rare moment of judgment and self-awareness, I forced myself to stop with the mechanical parts of the build that I always enjoy. Even going into the build, I knew that the real bear here was going to be my nemesis: firmware, macros, and actual programming. I just didn't know how bad it was gonna get. Right out of the gate, we had tons of issues with firmware in livestream number 3, specifically flashing the firmware to all of the respective boards that need to talk to one another. The LDO Nighthawk boards we had were on a newer version of Clipper, and we needed to flash the Sovol board to a specialized Big Tree Tech version of Clipper for some reason. And unfortunately, at the time, I was on a temporary and very crappy laptop, which made flashing the firmware to all the various boards even more difficult. We actually ended up spending almost an entire live stream, literally 4 hours, trying to download the STM flashing utility, which we couldn't get to download properly, and they were blocking me from actually downloading the software. And then once we got it, we spent the rest of the live stream just trying to get the boards connected to that crappy laptop to actually flash them. So yeah, off to a great start. Now, I'm not sure what the lesson is here, but it probably has something to do with first ensuring that you have a working computer and that you have an adapter for flashing eMMCs, as well as a clear understanding of exactly how you're going to flash each of the tool head boards before you start. Fortunately for me, Nadir, who continues to be a paragon of patience and steadfastness throughout this entire process, had a pretty good idea of how all of this needed to be done. But note that it can still be really confusing. The LDO Nighthawk toolhead boards, which use USB, are very, very convenient in terms of actually wiring them up. But as far as I recall, they do necessitate, therefore, that you use something called Catapult Bootloader to flash the firmware. Now, if you're not familiar with that, or like me, you find even normal firmware flashing processes to the tool head to be confusing and scary, this can get you hung up, especially if you need to do it 7 times. Now, after the endless quagmire of live stream number 3, things could only look up, right? And they did, for a brief second. In live stream number 4, we finally managed to get 2 tool heads wired up and flashed. We created and uploaded the initial configs for T0, T1, and T2. We successfully got Clipper to recognize them after flashing. We were making progress. We were so confident that we even started discussing the different stealth changer macros and tool changer logic. Was it really going to be this easy from here on out? Would we just need to mechanically mount the tool heads and bada bing bada boom, we'd have a 2 tool head changer which we could then gradually add more tools to? Nope. It started with a broken thermistor on the Fetus Rapido. My fault. We put it aside knowing that a replacement would take at least 2 weeks to get to me, not realizing that Fetus no longer had them in stock and it would end up being more like 2 months. Then it got worse, much worse. The dowel pins that we had ordered, the pins on which the entire tool changer mechanism are centered both literally and figuratively, turned out to be the wrong size. It turns out that when you order M5, that isn't the actual diameter of the outside of the pin, it's the diameter of the thread inside. What we actually needed were M3 dowel pins. Oops. That alone would be another 2 weeks, best case scenario, but with the war here, the holidays, and just general shipping delays typical to this country, that ended up being a month. Son of The lesson here is pretty clear. Before you take apart a perfectly good printer and begin working on it on a massive project like this, triple check that you have everything you need and that it's actually the right stuff that you need. Not just looking at the bag and saying, okay, yeah, I got everything, but actually check that it is what you need. I really tried, you guys. I tried to be more organized for this build than I ever have been before. I organized everything into this organizer and I did make sure that I had all the major components. But in the end, it was the little things, the bushings, the screws, the pins. Those were what ended up causing so many delays. And that is super frustrating. And unfortunately, this is a lesson that I had to learn again and again and again throughout this project. But hey, I mean, at least we had all the firmware stuff sorted, right? Wrong. In live stream 4, we also discovered that somehow the stock 8GB eMMC was already 92% full, which of course meant ordering a bigger 32GB one, and you guessed it, 2 to 4 weeks. But what's even worse than that, there is no way to flash an exact image of the firmware from one eMMC to another, at least not that we know of, and so we would basically need to start from scratch flashing the firmware to a completely new board, then connecting the tool head boards, then configuring the macros, transferring everything over that we'd already done manually, blah blah blah. So we lost a month just waiting on parts. I know, annoying. And at this point, I was pretty much done with firmware woes. So on stream number 5, we finally received all the delayed parts and were ready and able to move forward. Of course, seconds before the live stream started, I make sure to start us off on the right foot by dropping the entire printer and all of the bins and hardware that I had stacked on it, like this, right onto the floor, just, you know, to really set the tone for the rest of the build. But once the stream started and I gathered myself and all of the parts from the floor, we assembled the first Spartacus toolhead dock shuttle, complete with the brass bushings, the magnets, and the freshly arrived pins. We got the tap PCB sensor rigged up and connected to the toolhead board. But then, annoying issues started cropping up once again. First, we realized that we didn't have long enough screws for the LGX version of the toolheads and that we'd need to order the exceedingly rare M3x50s. No worries, we could still do the BMG versions of the tool heads, right? Now, it was time to try and get the stealth changer carriage onto the printer. The original SV08 belts are extremely short because they're held in place by these kinds of metal fins on the side. But for our setup, we need them to be pulled taut and then held behind the carriage itself, like a normal Voron installation. Try as I might, I couldn't get the belts behind the carriage with clamps or by pulling them in place with pliers, so we printed out this belt helper part to actually clamp the original SV08 belts and hold them in place while we tried to attach the new stealth burner carriage. But even with those belt helpers, it was an uphill battle. Finally, after an hour or more, I managed to pinch the belts behind the carriage, and because I didn't want to risk the belts coming loose and having to do all that over again, I made sure to tighten the screw to the carriage very, very well until...
I'm really hamming this thing.
No.
Yeah, I broke a screw off right in the MGN carriage. We tried to remove it, to drill it out. Nothing would work. Fortunately, I had an extra MGN 12 rail kicking around from Fizek, which was a really, really nice one with pockets CNC'd out of it for lighter weight. So in livestream 6, we took everything apart and swapped the rail. We drilled holes into the aluminum extrusion to account for the different hole placements and even used T-nuts in the back to hold it in place, which obviously isn't ideal. We once again struggled with those extra short belts again.
Yeah, I don't want to hurt my feelings.
And
oh, look at that. I broke another screw in the...
Are you freaking kidding me? First, the firmware. Then the pins. Then the belt. Then I broke a rail. Then I broke another. This was no longer a build. It was a war. And we were losing. I'd love to say that the rails weren't my fault. That I was using some cheap hardware or something that broke too easily, or that the LTT screwdriver I was using made it just too easy to over-torque, but it's also entirely possible that I was just not being cautious enough, too concerned about the belt slipping out, to exercise caution and maybe logic. There's probably a lesson there, but I don't really want to talk about it. Whatever it was, this would mean another 2 to 4 weeks of delays while we ordered some replacement rails, but here again, that ended up being more like 2 months. Now I'm going to get to the light at the end of the tunnel, and I promise there is some, in just a second, but at this point we do need to thank this video's sponsor, the makers of the SV08 that we're using for this project, Sovol. For those of you who are looking for a great budget printer or the base for your next project, whether it's a tool changer, an ultra-fast machine, or a multicolor system, or really whatever, I can highly recommend you check out Sovol. Their line of open source 3D printers, including the SV08, the Zero, and the SV06 Ace, offer ready-made and budget-friendly alternatives to more expensive do-it-yourself machines like the Voron 2.4, the 0.2, or the Prusa Mark 4S. I've been a fan of Sovol for a long time, and they are one of this channel's longest-standing supporters. So to check them out and help keep videos like this possible, then visit the link in the description. All right, back to the saga. At this point in the build, I needed some space from the project. I just could not stand to go through another 4+ hour live stream where all I do is dig myself further and further into a hole and break more things or discover more missing parts. Truthfully, I was ready to give up. I feel like I say that about just about every project on this channel, but honestly, it's true. It seems like every project that I do, I get to a point where I'm so frustrated, so fed up, that I lose sight of what it was that I was excited about in the first place. And honestly, I might have given up if it hadn't been for the literal village of support around me. First, there were the sponsors, companies who had sent me free products for this build and were expecting to see it completed. Then there was Nadir, who never got frustrated with me, never abandoned me, and never so much as expressed a negative word. And he was counting on me. There were all of you guys asking me in the comments about the project and expressing your excitement and anticipation. And then there was Jacques. Jacques, who, out of the kindness of his heart and maybe a little bit of pity, came down here from Jerusalem day after day after day after day and hopped on video calls with Nadir. The two of them worked together for hours, working through more firmware issues, flashing the toolhead board, setting up the new EMMC, all while I worked on other projects that actually pay the bills. I think the only work that I actually did on this project since the last live stream was printing and assembling the top hat and connecting and mounting all of the USB breakout boards and the power supply to the brackets. They did basically everything else together. They even got the thing running, moving, and homing, all with the belts temporarily glued in place. It was alive, and they didn't stop there. While we were waiting for the M3x50 bolts and the replacement carriage and rails, Jacques built all of the docks and prepared the printer to hold all of the tool heads too. And throughout all of this, like Nadir, He asked for nothing in return, though I did make sure to constantly keep Jacques supplied with a steady stream of kosher food deliveries, filament, and 3D printing accessories to express my heartfelt gratitude. But man, it's good to have friends. And I guess that, too, in and of itself, is a really important lesson here. It takes a village to build a tool changer, and I dare say that I would not recommend building one without someone else to help get you through it. Throughout this build, Nadir and Jacques have been an incredible support system, and I literally couldn't have done any of this without them. So, I don't know, but maybe you guys spam the comments, "Thank you, Jacques and Nadir," if you're glad that this project has been resurrected. So that's where we stand as of today. The firmware is flashed, the docks are assembled, the boards are talking to one another. But there is still a lot of work left to do. We need to build and connect the remaining four tool heads. We need to mount them to the carriages. We need to swap out the broken rail for a new one. We need to route all the wires to all the different tools, mount up the extra power supply and tool head board to the printer, and just generally deal with cable management. And then we need to deal with the alignment and the macros. And if my recent Box Turtle video has taught me anything, it's that you need to have everything super dialed in when print heads meet up against fixed objects. So I'm very grateful to Ember Prototypes for sending over their CXC tool to help us with the actual tool alignment. But we still do need to get all of the different dock positions right so that each tool docks in the right place and applies the right amount of pressure to lift and lower, and all of that. It is going to be a continuation of what has already been a long journey. If anything, I've learned that a tool changer isn't so much a build, but a test of character and grit. But hopefully, thanks to Jacques and Nadir getting me over the hump, I'll have more and more positive updates coming soon. But hey, I would love to hear your thoughts about the build so far and anything that you would like me to answer or address in the following videos and live streams. So drop a comment below and maybe hit that like button while you're down there. That's all for this week, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.